Hi everyone, welcome to the Sarah Moore and Midori show.
Hello everyone. Today we are so excited because we are talking money. We have the leading authority on financial security and how to find hidden money that you didn't even know about. He says that he can help us find $33,000 that we didn't even know about. So make sure you stay on and listen.
That is awesome. So as you know, I am Sara Moore, and this is my lovely co-host, Miss Midori. We're hosts of the world's first live streaming relationship talk show. I am the CEO at C Media, a social media agency, and I teach my clients how to build relationships using social media. I believe the ROI of these platforms stand for relationships, openness, and interest. And Miss Midori is an international relationship coach. She helps her clients build thriving relationships offline, and she incorporates modern techniques to help stomp out perceived limitations so she can create passionate and connected relationships. Right. And I'm so jealous.
We're gonna find you someone these days.
Yeah, together we merge this online and offline relationship talk show that has dynamic talk show guests who are pushing the limits in their businesses and building thriving relationships. So welcome to our show. Keep the conversation going with us on Twitter after the show's over. So
yeah. So welcome to the show. And, you know, I just got back last Thursday, of course. I had to leave right after because I was heading down to go see my son in LA. I'm in Northern California. He's in Southern California. So
right.
We went out to dinner one time and he told me about this group called Anonymous. Have you heard about them? They're hacksters. They call themselves vigilantes. And it's fascinating what these guys do. He showed me
videos. They hack? They're hackers?
They call themselves hacktivists. H-A-C-K-I-V-I-S. And they create all kinds of turmoil if they don't like you, if you don't listen to what they say. So like their first thing that they did, tell us if you guys have heard about them. They're called Anonymous, but they're almost like a movie. It's very well done. Obviously, they're very technically savvy, and it's throughout the world. There's these people who call themselves anonymous. Anyone can be part of the group. I could be part of the group, although I'd be kicked out because I don't know anything about technology. but it's throughout the whole world, and these people come together and they decide what really makes them angry. So the first thing that really made them angry that they came together on was on the Church of Scientology. So what they do is they will send you a video and say, you better do XYZ because we are not happy with you. Otherwise, look out, because we're gonna come back. So then they'll come back and they'll hack into all your stuff, into your website, into your financial stuff, everything, and take over.
Wow.
So I watched a video last night, and it was for, have you guys heard about the mayor? I don't know if he's still mayor, maybe they got him out, but the mayor of Denver.
Okay.
He came in and they were really unhappy with the way that he was treating the homeless. I guess there's a lot of people who passed away, and he did a lot of negative things to not help the homeless. So they sent him a warning and he didn't heed it. So they came back with a vengeance. And so I watched the video and they basically said, dude, you effed up. You didn't listen to us. So now we're going to reveal all your dirty laundry. He had hired escorts at least on 3 different occasions. So they got into that. And, you know, they're going to release everything out to the public. And what they say is at the very end, we don't forget, we don't forgive. And it is too late to see us coming. That means that they've already done it. They've already started screwing up all your stuff. Like, they don't like Donald Trump. So they released his cell phone number, all kinds of stuff.
Oh my word.
Yeah. So you have to, if you do get an email from them, that means that you've become really big and you need to listen to them.
Apparently,
you need to heed their warning.
But it is extreme. I was thinking for a minute, well, maybe they're like good activists, and
they do good stuff too. They
like helping the homeless. That sounds like, you know, they're like a voice for them, basically. But I don't think that's the way to solve a problem.
A lot of them have been arrested, but they also they've declared a war on ISIS. They've shut down a bunch of their stuff, apparently.
Oh, wow.
And then the Ku Klux Klan. So here's one of the things where you can see the positive and the negative. So they released all the names of those supposedly who are Ku Klux Klan, but apparently a lot of the people weren't Ku Klux Klan. It affected their children, may have had their kids' names on it, but they weren't, they may have somehow been associated with someone, but they weren't part of it.
Right.
So yeah.
Holy moly.
That's pretty amazing.
That is.
Do. Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway,
that was be cool if they could use like live streaming to like let us see everything behind the scenes.
I know.
Isn't that cool? Yeah,
that would be cool. Maybe they'll come on Blab. Should we invite them?
Yeah. We need to talk to these people.
We need to talk to you.
I was just telling you about before the show started that there is the new app that just came out, Busker. And I think it's so cool because it's the first platform where you can actually like receive money for doing live streaming work. I mean, think about how much time and effort goes into like preparing a show. You have to write, you have to have good notes, you have to be organized, you have to know, it's just like giving a speech, and there's so much time that goes into it, and you're giving all of this content to your viewers. And have you ever gotten something really good from somebody and you're like, gosh, I should pay them for what they just told me?
Yeah,
have you ever felt like that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. A lot of times.
And like, it's a way to just kind of give to your community. So I'm really excited about using it. I was hoping to use it today, but maybe we'll be able to dive in next week or something.
Yeah. We'll get that down a little bit more. I don't know. How do you guys feel that everyone who's on here, how do you feel about having to pay to watch a show? I don't know. I have mixed feelings. I know that they have tried to like sell videos. YouTube, you can set up a platform so that people have to pay to watch your videos, and it hasn't been very successful. So I don't know.
So yeah, well, I don't think you have to like set up a pay to watch. So people can just send through the streaming. You might be able to start a broadcast that does require, but I mean, the chances of you getting any viewers from it are probably slim. Unless you have a very big loyal following, you know?
Right.
But it's cool because the actual like definition of busker is, I'll read this, street performance or busking is the practice of performing in public places for gratuities. In many countries, the rewards are generally in the form of money, but other gratuities such as food, drink, or gift may be given. So that's what it means is it's you perform and people can, it's like standing on a street corner and people can tip you.
I like that.
Isn't it neat?
It's optional. I like that.
Yeah, exactly. It's optional.
And how cute is Ken? Ken said that he would pay. I paid for yours, but not sure until I've watched to see if another is worth it for others.
Right.
All that matters is that you would pay for ours. That makes us feel
good. That is so sweet. Thanks,
Thank
Ken.
You, Ken. You're now our favorite viewer.
Chris, I totally agree. Chris gives so much value and content that a lot of his would be easy to charge for. I agree. And that's part of it, you know? Like, we can't do work for free all the time, but I do believe in give, give, give.
Yeah.
But then there is a point of asking, you know, like, you can only give so much.
I was listening to, I don't know, you got me into this Gary Vee thing because you've talked about Gary Vaynerchuk a number of times. And so on my way to LA, which was 7.5 hours, I had a lot of time. So yeah. I listened to some of his interviews, podcast interviews, and he was getting really, really angry. Because you know how he's a big personality. If you guys haven't ever met or haven't listened to Gary Vaynerchuk, he has a big ego and he has a lot of passion.
Right.
And so what he was saying was, you know, I give all this free content. I have podcasts, I have shows, I have, you know, blue, what do you call them? Like the blueprints. He has all kinds of stuff that he gives, and then he tries to sell a book. And then those same people who kept on getting, don't go out and buy his book. So he was just expressing how that makes him very, very passionately angry.
Well, his stance on everything too, Midori, I kind of quit listening to him. I told you that.
You did,
I'm kind of, I'll just say this out loud. I'm in thought to create a book similar to what Gary has created, that says, what's the name of his book?
Oh, I don't remember.
Not Crush It, but it's the new one. Thoughts from an entrepreneur, a modern day entrepreneur or something. No, here, I got to look it up. Well, anyways, it'll take me a minute. So I always thought, like, well, maybe I should write one from like a female standpoint, because just like Haywood, what is your name? He turns people off, and he actually says that when he gets on a stage to talk to his audience, he tells himself that he needs to be mad at these people. I don't think you should get on stage and be mad at people.
He's a little bit angry. A lot of the pictures I see, he looks a little angry.
And I'm really turned off by that, because that does not line up with my philosophy on life at all. I don't think that we need to be angry at anybody. I think that we should all live in harmony. And if we're not doing something right, we're human and intelligent enough to be aware that maybe we should change something that we're doing and work to do it. And those are the type of people I want to be around and have listened to my shows anyways. I don't want people that I need to be angry at. So,
yeah, he's interesting. I mean, there's a lot of the things that he said, I agreed with him. Some people should not be entrepreneurs. He talks about, I mean, like, I don't like the terms he uses. I think he called them like A and B and C. Have you heard him talk about this concept?
Talk about what concept?
Where he feels that not everyone should be an entrepreneur. There's people who, that's just not their zone of genius. And I agree with that. It's, you need to be a bit crazy, as you and I are, clearly. But also, it's just certain people do great in other roles. Mm-hmm. But yeah,
it's your giftedness. I mean, it is a gift. You can like train yourself to be a leader, but to stick with entrepreneurism and to say that is truly what you are, that is a whole different ball game, you know?
Right.
I agree with it too. But this is funny. Chris says that guys don't turn him on, and that he doesn't turn him on. He doesn't turn me on either. So, and I'm a female, so.
That's funny. Yeah, no, he definitely doesn't do it for me. I can't ever imagine making out with him. Ugh.
Me neither. These are terrible thoughts. Can we bring Chris on now?
Shall we bring him on? Chris, you ready to hop on? Okay, so let me just tell you how cool the guy is. Chris Miles, who is going to be our guest today, he is the cash flow expert. He's a leading authority on how to quickly free up and create cash flow for thousands of his clients, entrepreneurs, and others internationally. He's an author, speaker, and radio host that's been featured in US News, CNN Money, Bankrate, Entrepreneur on Fire, and has spoken to thousands, getting them fast financial results. Chris truly is the financial advocate for the entrepreneur. In fact, his average client, I said it early, finds $33,000. There's a lot I could do with an extra $33,000. Chris,
me too.
Right? Chris consistently teaches audiences how to do what no other financial advisors can or will to achieve financial prosperity. So we're going to find out what those secrets are today, now and in the future, while spending time doing what they love most. Does that sound pretty enticing to me? It does,
yes.
Right?
Yes. And there he is. Hi,
there
Chris.
He is.
Hey.
Thanks for being here, Chris.
You bet.
I know. Oh my gosh, your credentials and the things that you can do for people. I just feel like you're a magician.
Not bad. You're going to show us. Dropout, huh?
Right?
For a college dropout, is that what you just said?
Yeah.
Wow. So are you self-taught? Did you do all that? Did you learn all your financial expertise on your own? Or did you have a mentor?
I had help. Yeah. I mean, I started out about 14 years ago being a financial advisor. I did that for 4 years, but I came to a quick realization that it doesn't work. You know, the stuff that you've been taught in the media, the news, all the mainstream advice is crap, especially if you're a business owner.
Right.
I mean, because it hasn't worked. I mean, we've been given that stuff for decades and still people are still broke. So the definition of insanity, right? Doing the same thing over and over, expecting a different result is kind of what's been happening. And it was in 2006 that actually I was introduced to a few guys that were millionaires. Some of them even younger than I was at the time. I was 28 at that time. And they said, no, this is bull crap. Like, you know, high risk rates, high return. That's false. You know, it's low risk, you know, things like that. And, you know, in it for the long haul, but how long is the long haul if the markets go down, you know, and that kind of thing. It's like, it's about how you go about creating value for people. That's where real wealth is. And when I started to do that, I actually quit being a financial advisor. I said, I'll never teach about money again. I was a liar and a deceiver. I will just teach ballroom dancing and go from there, you know? But I ended up, because of that, people kept coming to me saying, wait, how are you doing what you're doing? Because I went from March of 06 quitting as a financial advisor with almost no money to all of a sudden in July of 06, able to retire with only a few thousand dollars in my checking account.
Wait, what were those dates again?
So March of 2006, I quit being a financial advisor and I had basically almost no money, like very little money at all to my name. In July of 06, I was able to retire.
What?
April, May, June, July. Wait, 4 months?
Uh-huh.
Okay, now, so who did you kill and rob?
that's what some people would say.
Who died? Did you inherit something? Happened.
Like I said, I only had $2,000 in my checking account. You know, the key was I was able to create cash flow streams coming in. And how it was is because people kept coming to me saying, hey, you're doing great stuff. Well, who do you recommend for this or this or this? And before I knew that term was, I started creating really good affiliate relationships. Mm-hmm. And one of those millionaires, he said, hey, if you're sending business to somebody's way, why don't you ask to see what their marketing fee is? Ask to get a split on that. And I was like, wow, I could do that, huh? Mm-hmm. And so I quit being a financial advisor. I was actually teaching some ballroom dancing and doing mortgages and things like that. But I eventually started referring people that would just come to me for questions saying, hey, who do you know that does blank? And I was able to refer them out. And next thing you know, I was making like $4,000 or $5,000 a month just because I was a really good connector.
That's awesome.
And that was just my way. But I mean, there's several ways to do it. My clients do it from all ways, usually within their businesses, able to retire themselves too. And so that's a fun thing.
Able to retire, you mean there's passive income. So there's that cash flow. That's what you're talking
about. Right. Like I was working like 3-4 hours a week. So take that, Tim Ferriss, you know.
There you go. You did
Woo!
It. Wow. Yeah. Okay. So you have to tell us more about that. I have so many questions, but I'm going to jump right in there because you brought it up. So I have to know. So you had your own, you didn't really have your own business. You just started referring people out and then getting a split on that.
Right. Yeah. I mean, like, that's the thing is like, I kind of stopped being in the business to a certain degree because I was like, okay, I got to hit the reset button. I got to learn. And so I was starting to be mentored by some of these guys. And, you know, cause I'm like, hey, if some of these guys are younger than I am, like some of them in their mid-20s, they're millionaires. I got to know what they know. It drove me nuts. And the crazy thing is it wasn't all about strategies. It was a lot about principles. Like what are those timeless principles that work always, you know? And so when they started to teach that and then I could combine the strategies with it, things started really accelerating quickly.
So what are some of those strategies?
Well, you know, like one of them I mentioned was dollars follow value. You know, dollars follow the value you create for other people. It's weird because like in the old, you know, mentality, it was kind of like, okay, what can I do to, like you were saying, either cheat, lie, you know, convince somebody to give you money, right? Versus coming from a place of service, coming from a place of how can I create a win-win for you? How can I give you what you want? And as I started to focus on that and obsess over that day in and day out, that's when things started to happen. And that's when people would come to me and say, hey, Chris, like I'm trying to figure out like about this or that. And so people would say, you know, Chris, like I want to not be paycheck to paycheck. How do I do that? And I'd be like, oh, you've got like equity in your house, right? Like, oh my gosh, you could do this or this or this with your equity and you do this or this. And they're like, wow, that's awesome. Well, who do I go to get a refinance? Well, go talk to that guy, you know? And I found a guy that I trusted, a guy that was really good doing the paperwork. I hate paperwork personally. Like I love teaching, but I hate paperwork.
Yeah.
And so even though I was mortgage licensed at that time, I would just say, cool, we'll go talk to this guy over here. He's great. He would do the paperwork. He would pay me 50% kickback for anybody I sent him because they were ready to buy. They just had to do paperwork and that was it.
So this was 2006. The real estate market was hot at that point. And we all know what happened in 2008. So obviously you are still successful. So you must have changed it up a little bit because
I had to.
Yeah. People's values in their homes went. So,
but did you still use the principle of you don't have to build it to make money from it? You can use what somebody else has already created or is doing well or is good at. You can use them to make money.
Leverage their abilities. Yeah. And I mean, there's like people I was referring to, like jewelry companies, you know, like, hey, you're looking for a good engagement ring. Great. This company's wholesale is awesome. And they pay me like $50 or $100 or whatever. Right. And like, there's little things you could do too. But I mean, that wasn't the only thing, but that's how I got started. What happened is that people kept seeking me out, like friends and people that saw what was changing my life. And so pretty soon I was starting to coach people from my house for free. And you know what? That totally sucked because they didn't do anything. Like, because they were getting free advice, right? They're like, oh, that's cool. I'm like, yeah, go do it. It's awesome. And then they go do nothing. I'm like, oh, this is stupid. Right. And then in 2007, a few millionaires like reached out to me and said, hey, we're looking to build up this company. Basically do what you've done, what we've all done. Let's actually go and teach this stuff. And so we created a company together. We're in partners together for like 6 years. And it's interesting, during that time, our whole market were real estate investors. Like almost everybody we're teaching. So it was a perfect storm of crap, right? Because I mean, we had like, you know, all these people that are like paying us, and then also they couldn't pay us anymore. Plus I cut off some of my income streams, ironically, to do that. I was like, I'm going to come out of retirement. I'm going to actually start teaching again and working out of an office, you know, heaven forbid, you know, and started doing that. And the next thing I know, like it, you know, we had this whole, you know, whole like great recession, you know? And so that was, it kind of took me from a place of millionaire to upside down millionaire, almost like over a year or two, which was really interesting to go through. And so I did have to change it up. The cool thing is I had to learn, right? I had to learn how to deal with the scarcity because the mind is the biggest thing you have to control when it comes to money. So battling that scarcity and trying to choose abundance instead. And especially when I was supposed to be the guy that had it all figured out. And I went, you know, I really went to a place where I was in the debt about $1 million. But from the things I started to learn, the resources and the tools I started to develop in that crappy situation, right? That's where I started to develop my cash flow process. And because people would come to me and they're like, Chris, I would love to work with you, but I can't find the money. And I was like, listen, if I can find the money, you can. If I was in the hole $16,000 each month, like I was short $16,000 a month between my business and my personal, I'm sure I can find something in your situation. And I would. And that's how I get people to start work with me. And so I started to take those very same tips and gradually evolve those and develop them over time, where pretty soon in the next 3.5 years, I was able to pay off over $900,000 of that debt.
Wow.
And be able to get back and now get to the place where there's positive cash flow again, you know, and things like that. And now I'm doing it much differently. Now I'm, you know, I'm working as a consultant. Now the cash flow is the focus. And again, I'm kind of like working like maybe 10, 20 hours a week doing what I do.
And then you get to come on shows like this and have fun, right?
Well, that's part of my 10 to 20 hours. Yeah.
That's great.
Okay, yeah, so sorry. What? I was just going to ask. So if you don't care, Midori, so it's not always enough just to like bring the money in, right? We're constantly leaking money. Uh-huh. And there's even just this week, I called to see if I could save money on my car insurance. My current company told me, no, there's no way. And then I called in another company and I was able to cut it down by like $35 a month. Mm-hmm. And that's $35 a month is a lot when it adds up over time. So what are your kind of strategies? Do you have any where we might be able to stop leaking some of this money that we're working so hard to bring in?
Yeah. The first step I have everybody do is start tracking their money, because whatever you put your attention towards will expand and grow, but whatever you ignore will also leave you. It's like your teeth, right? Like if you stop brushing your teeth and flossing and all that kind of stuff, eventually you look like this. You know? That doesn't work, you know? Like you're going to lose them. If you ignore your health, you'll lose it. You ignore your relationships, right, Midori? If you ignore your relationships, you lose them. And if you ignore your money, you lose it too. And so as that true principle, we got to make sure that we're paying attention to what's coming in and what's going out. It's interesting. In scarcity, there are two mindsets in scarcity. One's a spender. They like to see what's coming in, but they like to ignore what's going out, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But there's also the saver, which is also in scarcity. They ignore what's coming in. They only look at how to minimize all their expenses. They want to be cheap. Mm-hmm. The problem is you can never save your wealth. You can never pay off enough debt fast enough. There's never enough in those two mentalities. So the middle of the road, the one that takes the best of both, is the steward. The steward takes the best and the spender and the saver puts it together, because the steward's looking to see, How can I expand and grow my stewardship? How can I manage what I have? How can I manage and increase it, right?
Right.
And that's the goal. And so track your money is key. In your business, QuickBooks is a great program to use because you can go online. It's easy. It can connect with all your bank accounts, do a lot of the work for you instead of writing a piece of paper or an Excel spreadsheet that takes you, you know, 3 days to do at tax season. And then you wonder why you lost so much money in your business because you're spending all that time doing your taxes, right?
Right.
Mm. You can do that. So QuickBooks is great, or mint.com is a great free resource for your personal life. And I have people use that as well as a free resource. So mint.com is great.
Is that right? Is that how you spell it?
Exactly. Yep.
I use that. I use that for a while and I forgot all about it. Obviously, I'm not focusing enough on my finances.
What were your thoughts on using it, Midori?
It was great. It just made it super simple. It's free.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And it's a great app. And I think everyone should be on it because you can see just everything right there. And it didn't take that long to set it up. And once it's set up, it's brainless.
Yeah. Right. I mean, everything is real time. I mean, think of all the times you have to go and log in all these different accounts to see where you're at, but to have it all in one place.
Yeah.
And to have it track for you. And a lot of it, like I have people track the transactions, like categorize everything so they know where they're spending in which area. And that seriously, like I've timed myself logging in to logging out just 1 week. If you do that once a week, I timed myself. It was just over 4 minutes that it took me to do all that, see where I'm at, and then get out. I mean, 4 or 5 minutes a week, that's it. I mean, if you include your business, maybe it's 10 to 15 minutes a week. But I wish I could have rock hard abs in 10 to 15 minutes a week to be physically fit. But if you can be financially fit 10 to 15 minutes a week, that's freaking awesome. Right?
Yeah, agreed.
So I'm ambitiously lazy. I like to do easy stuff.
Well, it's working for you. So we want to learn from people like you. Yeah. So what are some, you know, Sara brought it up that she called her insurance company and she was able to save some money. Are there some other places that you see that are very typical for people or businesses where they are just the money is flowing out?
Yeah. One is if people aren't tracking, to go along with the last point, if they say they're too busy to track their money as a business owner, I've always found at least $500 a month they're overspending. In just the most random areas. Sometimes just getting them to pay attention will recover that money because they're like, oh, I didn't know I was going out. They just spend whatever you make, right? Mm-hmm. So tracking money is key. Insurances are great. Either one, lowering your costs without hopefully lowering your protection, because that's key. I teach that with my one-on-one clients. Also, duplicate insurances is big. Sometimes people will have like these extra cancer policies or things like that, or short-term disability. You're like, well, get the long-term. It's cheaper and it's really covering you better anyways. So things like that, right? I had one guy, we saved about $900 a month on life insurance costs that he was having.
Wow.
That it was huge for him, especially where we were trying to shut down one branch of his business. He was doing catering and a restaurant. If we shut down the restaurant, we saved $3,000 a month of losses he was taking. So the catering business was funding the restaurant. So we cut down the restaurant, got rid of that, saved $3,000 a month plus $900 a month on life insurance and some other things. We found like almost 50 grand that year.
That's so cool.
So that's a big one. For business owners, one of the biggest ones are taxes. Like that one is huge because, give an example, like most people don't realize how much you can actually write off as a business owner because most people have a passive accountant that just says, here, give me your numbers. All right, this is what you owe, right? That's pretty much most accountants. Mm-hmm. Not like, here, let me teach you some cool strategies in the middle of the year before it's over. You know, things like corporate rent, you know, where you can actually rent your place where you live. You can rent, have your company rent from you just one day a month, say, for example, so you don't go over those 14 days a year. And guess what? You can take that money income tax free. So, I mean, if you pay yourself like $1,250 12 times that year, that's $15,000 a year you take tax free as income. That saves you anywhere between $3,500 and $6,000 a year right there. Like, bam, just like that.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So things like that. I mean, just how you structure your corporation, how you pay yourself, all those kind of things. I mean, the things you write off, huge. I find at least $5,000 to $10,000 a year with most business owners just right there.
That's awesome. Okay. So let's say you own a business. Mm-hmm. And you own a property or two or whatever, and things just aren't going well. You're feeling buried and you need to do some type of drastic change because you just can't keep up. So when do you advise your clients to claim bankruptcy versus a foreclosure?
Very rarely do I ever recommend bankruptcy because even in my situation, I was able to avoid it because I got to the point where I just said, listen, like, unless they're like trying to threaten to throw me in prison, you know, or whatever, like, you know, for not paying. Not that there's never a debtor's prison, so you don't have to worry about that, right? But unless they're like putting my back against the wall, I'm going to pay those people back, but I'm going to do it the way I can best do it. And so I never went for bankruptcy. Not saying that you shouldn't do that, but minority of cases, I would say that it's even, you even need to go towards the bankruptcy route, you know? Mm-hmm. For people that are in a bad place, it depends. Like if you're about to lose your house or whatever, like, I mean, I get it. Like I lost a home. I lost a $750,000 home, you know, that I was trying to short sell. And so, you know, it kind of sucks. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if it means like it's what's necessary to get you back on your feet again, then great. Maybe the foreclosure is the way to go. It's not the best, but there are other options, you know. I try to focus people not just in minimizing expenses, but increasing income too, mm-hmm. because that helps, especially if you can keep it. It's not about how much money you make. It's how much you keep and then make on top of it, right? That's mm-hmm. where it gets really fun. So you got to look at both. So I look at both income and expenses. How can we make more money too and dig yourself out of the hole that way? And in fact, I had a client where they were in the hole $3,000 a month and wonder if they had to lose their house, but we were able to get some things going. We were able to consolidate some loans, do some cool stuff. And we actually got them out of that hole and back to the place where they were making money again.
Wow.
So yeah, in fact, just last month, I had somebody that freed up $4,163 a month just by restructuring their debt. It was fun.
Oh, wow.
She worked for a bank, by the way.
Sorry, I was going to ask, before we get too far away from this subject, uh-huh. I'm ringing again. Can you hear it? Ken asked that he belongs to a business group and it's hard for him to ask for a referral fee and he does it all the time. So he's wondering, how do you ask your referral partners for a cut without sounding needy?
Well, the way you just do it is just ask them, just say, hey, do you have a marketing budget? Do you have a referral type of program? Because a lot of people, I mean, if you ask any business owner, and every time I've asked it in a big group, I would ask them, I'd say, by a raise of hands, who would pay for hot referrals? And all of them were like raising their hands, like, duh, of course I would, right? Because it's the cheapest, easiest marketing we've got. So it's like, great, what's your marketing budget? You know, everybody has their own. Now, you might not say 50%, and that's because I was doing a lot of the legwork for them by bringing the people mm-hmm. in, you know, just basically feeding them the people so you can do the paperwork, right? But it depends on how much value you're adding. I mean, some people, like I said, like that, there's that diamond company that pays me like maybe $50 or $100 for getting a couple $1,000 engagement ring, right? I mean, mm-hmm. that's their cut. It's like 5% or whatever. Others might be 10 or 20. The thing is just open up the dialogue. I mean, and also check yourself too, because if you're not personally willing to pay for referrals, I can guarantee that energetically you're putting that out to where they won't either.
Right.
Because you ever notice that a lot of the problems you see people give you excuses and crap is usually the same thing you say in your own head, but then you're like, oh, but hey, you should be doing that too. And no, like, you know, if you're not willing to do it, then they aren't either, you know?
That's interesting because you're totally right. So, you know, the term affiliate, it seems to, I've been hearing that it has a negative connotation, you know, in what I do, there's a lot of affiliates and a lot of, mm-hmm. you know, affiliate splits is how a lot of us grow. So, you know, what about setting something up like that? Some people have it on their website, so you can just go straight to their website and there's an affiliate link. Are there new things that we should know about that make it a little bit easier?
Well, it depends. Like I tend not to do a lot of affiliate link type stuff because the problem with affiliate programs lately is that people are just, try not to use bad words here, but people are just throwing themselves out there, like, pitching anybody, right? Yeah. And I think that's just ridiculous. I think it should be authentic and genuine. Mm-hmm. Like it should be something that you would recommend normally, whether you got paid or not. And that's kind of my general principle and rule is that, you know, I would refer them regardless if I got paid, you know, and that shows. But most people are looking for affiliates. It's like, hey, you got a big list. I got a big list, a shared list or whatever. And then they just kind of red light themselves out there, right? You know, it's like the red light special. So that's the problem is like that kind of stuff turns us off, you know, but if it's done from a genuine nature, from a general place, way easier.
Yeah, definitely.
So contracts are good, but I don't think you have to have massive affiliate links or anything like that.
Okay. I have a question. So once upon a time I was married I would get so frustrated because he would go to the gas station and spend, I'm not kidding, like $20 a day. And I'm like, how do you even spend that kind of money? He would buy pop, candy, whatever else you get at a gas station. I didn't even know. And it used to drive me nuts because I just pay at the pump and that's all I get at a gas station is my gas, you know?
Yeah.
And what do you do if somebody's the spender in the relationship or somebody, the other person is not okay with that? Do you have any, is this more of a Midori question, relationships?
It is. And I ask this question a lot. So no, go for it. That's a good question.
Okay.
Cool. That is a good question. You know, it's funny. I work with couples that usually they're the opposite ends of the spectrum. Remember how I mentioned there's spenders and savers and the stewards mm-hmm. in the middle. I get a lot of spenders and savers somewhere in that place. They tend to marry each other. It's funny.
Totally guilty.
You know, totally guilty.
Uh-huh. Are you the spender or the saver?
I'm the saver. We've been together for almost 30 years. And so I have come in this way and he's come in this way, but you know, we're still working on it. So that's why I'm so interested to hear what are your tips on this?
See, that's the Japanese blood in you because man, like, you know, 30 years, people are like, yeah, right. What were you, like 5? You know, come on.
Yes. I was 5.
I was 5.
Yeah. It was arranged marriage.
That's right. Yeah. So when you're dealing with that, like there really has to be a bigger reward for the other person. There has to be a bigger why, right? And so it comes back to that. It's like, what do they really want? And why are they spending? Because I'll tell you, like sometimes spenders get a bad rap for stuff that's very easy to understand. I had one couple I worked with up in Idaho, you know, like one guy was a chiropractor and then his wife was there and she was raised by a father who was a business owner. And that father like constantly went bankrupt like 3 times while she was a kid. So they're losing things all the time. They're in a state of flux, never anything consistent, right? So her whole thing she was projecting on him was like, hey, I can't even do that. Like there's no way. Even though he was making good money, she was still projecting the fact that, you know, oh, he's going to go broke anytime. Like it's going to happen. Yeah. I'm so worried I'm going to lose money, right? So it's funny that she would have that one from the saver perspective. And then the spender, I've had spenders where they've been like, they've had like really anal, like tightwad type parents that would never do anything. They would never do it, take any vacations, never do anything fun. And so when they became adults, they vowed that they would never become that parent and they would actually enjoy life right now. Right. Mm-hmm. And see, the problem is like, you just kind of go over the extreme. Like I said, stewardship is in the middle. Money is meant to be used and spent, right? But we want to spend it in a way that can create more time, more money, and ultimately more freedom, more options, right? So when you try to find that freedom aspect, you try to connect the two together. A lot of times both parties will come together in the middle, mm-hmm. you know, kind of that, you know, Diamond Rio song, right? Meet in the middle.
Yeah.
You know, kind of like that. Right. And what happens is that they start to both see each other's point of view and there's a lot more peace created in the relationship, which has been really cool. So for spenders, it's just got to give them a bigger why of how can they have more freedom, more money if mm-hmm. they avoid just doing those little things like that. But you got to understand, you got to get to the why. Why are they doing it? Because everybody has their own story.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And that's so true. For us, it's helped that we meet once a week now. And we have, it's basically a business meeting. And we talk about the finances. We actually sit and look at them. And so we're on the same page together. And it's helped in so many ways. Our debts are getting paid off. And mm-hmm. we don't fight as much over.
Yeah.
You know, it just creates more harmony. So
that's exactly what I have my clients do is meet weekly. Like talk weekly about it and actually enjoy the conversation, not fight about it, especially when there's more years of marriage. When you have decades of marriage, there's all these stories behind it. And a lot of times there's all this like finger pointing and accusing. And it's like, no, guys, like let's chill out. Even if we have to pretend like you're looking at somebody else's situation, like somebody else's finances so that you don't take everything personally. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you have to do some little ninja tricks to get people to be peaceful about it, you know?
It's very true. And the other thing is the first meeting we yelled, it happens, but then if you keep on doing it on a regular basis, you start coming together and it gets a lot more peaceful and fun. So, it does. Cause then you can see what you're saving. Yeah. And you can see it. And then you can say, you know, you have goals. This is stuff I teach, but you have goals. What do you want? Do you want to buy a new house in Santa Barbara? Or do you want to go on vacation? Yeah. And you're working towards it. So it satisfies everybody involved.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, you're always talking about goals and the next step and something to go for rather than just here's our numbers, blah, 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 the end. Like it's way more fun. There's more heart to it. There's more life to it. And it helps. And then afterwards you can be like, hey, cool. You know, chest bump, you know, whatever.
That's what we do. That's what we do. Really? Big old chest bump.
I bet you do.
So, yeah. Okay. Well, gosh, we could go on all day.
We could. It is time.
It is time for our next section, Chris. And I don't know that you've ever gotten to play the truth or truth game before. Have you?
No.
So I actually went, we gave you a little bit of a break because you have 6 kids and they're young. So I'm assuming you don't get tons of sleep. So we're going a little easy on you today, but this is fun. So we're going to ask you questions and you just have to answer them. And it has nothing to do with business or finance. This is us getting to know your secrets.
All right.
Okay.
I'm ready.
First question. What are you most afraid of?
Bees. I scream like a little girl when I'm around, when there's bees around.
Oh man. That's like my 8-year-old. He's like, Mom, there's a bee. And he shoves Avit down and I'm like, leave the kid alone. Like nothing's going to happen, you know? And
he shoves Avit down to what? To get past him?
To try to protect Avit. He's like, run, but Avit falls. And it's like, you're hurting the kid when you should be killing the bee. And
Oh, yeah, I love when we get texts. There's a bunch of bees on them from little kids, like bee, 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 bee. I'm like, does that scare you? Even my kids know.
poor dad.
Okay, your next question is, what is your silliest pet peeve?
My silliest pet peeve?
Yeah. Oh. Or I guess just biggest pet peeve. It says silliest, but we could just say biggest.
Biggest pet peeve. My biggest pet peeve are fake people. Like people that just like try to portray something, like they try to act a certain way, but you know that's not them at all. Like that just drives me nuts. And maybe that's because like I've had to fight so hard to not be a people pleaser myself to try to gain friends. And so, you know, to see that like just drives me nuts, you know.
And so it seems like the people who are bragging the most are the ones who are the most insecure, right? Uh-huh. The ones who are telling you about their new car, their new boat, whatever it is, or you know how great they are. It seems like those are the ones who.
I used to do that. Yeah, I bought the nice big house, Mercedes, and everything to put stuff in front of me to show you know my value. Mm-hmm. But once those things were taken away, I had to basically look at myself, and that's when I realized the real value is from within.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's a little humbling. Yeah. Okay. So. Oh, this is a good question. Okay, now we're warming up a little. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
If you got to be a woman for one day, what would you do during the day?
I would probably cry and sleep.
Cry and sleep? What?
Wait for that day to come back as a man.
Really? You would never want to be the opposite for just one day just to see?
Oh, I kind of have a female like brain anyways, so that's the problem, I guess. So. You know, I don't know. I guess, what would I do? I don't know. I probably would be like, I don't know what the heck to do. I probably wouldn't do much different other than try to figure out how to, you know, put on clothes. You know, that might take half the day right there.
You'd be curling your hair. I see it. You would actually.
I have naturally curly hair, but it's really short, you know, so.
That's true. You'd be getting your makeup on.
Yeah. It'd be like, you know, all over the place.
That would be funny.
Okay, so
I here's with sweatpants. That's what I do. Yeah.
Go to the grocery store with sweatpants. I do that all the time. But if you could commit any crime and get away with it, what would it be?
Ooh, commit any crime and get away with it. I'm probably speeding. I would. Like, you know, going on trips, like I hate going from like destination to destination. I want to get there as fast as possible. But the thing that slows me down is just like, oh, what if I get pulled over? I want to do that. Mm-hmm. So I would just love to just open up and just go as fast as possible.
Yeah. You know?
That would be a good one to like be able to always block a cop that you could just keep speeding. Yeah. You know, that'd be awesome.
That's right. Outrun the cops. You know, then you know you got it.
Yeah.
Well, in Germany, they have the Autobahn. Have you ever been there?
Never, but I've heard about it and it's crazy.
Yeah, my husband was there. He played football in Germany and he said it is crazy. He thought he was going to die. He wasn't driving. But when I drive, he does that. He holds on super tight and yells at me. But yeah.
Yeah, I love the side seat drivers.
Yeah, right. Right. Funny. Okay. Last question. What would people say if they could read your mind?
I'm tired.
Really?
My mind is very random. Have you guys ever watched the TV show Psych?
No, I haven't heard of it.
Okay. So that kind of sense of humor where it's just like really quick little side shot tangents, you know, it's like little things that go off. Mm-hmm. That's kind of how my mind works. And that's kind of what comes out of my mouth if I just let my mouth open up. So I restrain myself for interviews like this because I can say totally all these little side comments, but then nobody would follow me. Nobody would ever hear what I'm saying. So they would get tired. They'd be like, I can't. In fact, I had an event where I had a professional comedian there and he was laughing his head off, but then his wife was there and she's like, you know, it's great material, but I cannot follow that guy. And he's like, I get it. Like it's, you know, I think it's great. But for her, like, she's like, I have a headache. I can't stand this. So that's what was happening in my head, really, is all the things I don't say, you know.
And trying to suppress it.
Exactly.
No wonder you're tired. That's funny.
Okay, so we usually do this next segment called Popcorn Questions, but I'm not sure if Midori and I should still answer them because we've answered them before. But we like to ask all of our guests this because it gives us some more insight into kind of your expertise and maybe where we can find more information about areas that we can improve on. So there's a series of three questions. The first one is, what podcasts or video blogs do you listen to regularly?
Besides my own?
Mm-hmm. Oh, good.
I mean,
there's
a Chris Miles Money Show that, you know, it's kind of weird listening to my own voice again because I'm like, oh, well, that's me, you know. Mm-hmm. And when did I say that? Yeah. But I mean, there's my show that I listen to, but other than my show, right? A podcast show is sometimes I'll listen to Entrepreneur on Fire. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I've been a guest on that a few times. Another one as well is one that's called Mechanic to Millionaire, which is an interesting one. Yeah, it's kind of an interesting one. That guy, he was a mechanic and he was able to go from there to become a millionaire by changing his thoughts and everything else. So cool podcast.
Yeah. That is cool.
That sounds interesting.
Very money focused, is it? A money focused show?
Some of it, yeah. It's got definitely some money principles as well. And a lot of things like law of attraction and things like that. You know?
That's cool stuff. Just real quick, and I know we're not doing ours, but because I drove 7.5 hours to LA and then 7.5 hours back, I listened to a lot of stuff. But my son turned me on to the podcast Startup. Have you guys heard of that?
No.
And I only listened to a couple from season two, but it's all about this guy who starts a podcast and he's been really, really successful. And if you ask me his name, I have no clue. I don't remember. But he talks like season one is all about him starting up his podcast and how he's accomplished all these goals and huge, huge setbacks. And then the next season, which I'm starting to listen to, is where he starts following a business from the very start. So it's this dating app. And it shows them just getting totally shut down by this huge investor in front of everybody. And he basically said, this is the effing worst company I've ever heard of. I mean, it was humiliating. And then they got invited to go on to, I think it's the Y3 incubator, which is one of the biggest ever. It's huge in the Silicon Valley. And they're doing really well. So that's as far as I've gotten. But it's interesting.
Yeah, one of my favorite TV shows is called The Prophet. Have you guys ever heard of that?
Yeah.
Love that show. That's a great one. If you want, it's like Shark Tank, but you actually get to see what they do.
Oh,
and I love that guy.
Yeah.
The main guy. I think he's fantastic.
Totally.
Okay, I've never seen it or heard of it. Okay. The next one is, what book do you recommend that has changed your life or mentality?
Oh, in which way? That's the problem, right?
You can name a couple.
A couple of them. I would say the basic one, like if I recommend the one I love is called, you know, How to Win Friends and Influence People. Mm-hmm. I think that's a classic. That's just incredible. It's great. Mm-hmm. So many good truths. I think that's the crux of be able to create business because wealth is created through relationships and conversation, right? So I think that's a huge one. Another one that's been big for me is Master Key to Riches by Napoleon Hill.
Okay.
So it's a follow-up to Think and Grow Rich.
Uh-huh.
Great one there. And then a short read that I really love is called Acres of Diamonds.
What's that?
Acres of Diamonds is a book. It's actually a speech from the early 1900s. For the guy that started Temple University. And he talks about using the story of Acres of Diamonds where, you know, someone went searching for all this wealth only to realize that the diamonds were on his property the whole time. but he went worldwide, spent his whole life looking for them, but they were right there. Wow. So trying to find that stuff that's already there, buried within, trying to bring that out. So great stuff there. It's a really short read, really short, the small little book, but amazing, amazing principles.
Oh, that's so good.
I haven't heard of that. I'm going to get that.
I know. Me too.
There you go. Just found it. It's on my desk.
Acres of Diamonds.
Yep. That's backwards, but Russell Conwell.
You know, for us, we see it right. We see it correctly.
Oh, good. It's just backwards for me.
Love it.
I wonder why.
I don't know. I've always been a little bit backwards.
People anymore because they're gone. We're on our own. But anyway, did you guys all hear, everyone who's here, because obviously you know about Blab, that Blab has, especially Mark, I saw Mark on here, that Blab has moved on from what it sounds like. They are not going to be helping us out anymore on this platform. And they've since opened up Swipe to Chill, which is their new app. So we'll see what happens with Blab. We'll see if we're here next week.
Yeah.
But you know what? I told you that, didn't I, Midori? Didn't I tell you that I thought they were in talks with something else? That was my hunch. Don't you remember? Like, because all of the updates that weren't coming through, it was kind of the sign. Like, we need more updates. We need more support. And it wasn't coming. And I just knew, like, there's something else in the pipeline. They're working on something else. And that's it.
You were right. You always said you're very intuitive, and you just
I did. That is a moment. Good thing it's recorded.
Totally. Sara was right again. Oh my gosh. Okay, so tell us how we can find out more information about you, Chris. Where can we find your show? And then I know you have a website, so tell us all that stuff.
Yep. So I mentioned the Chris Miles Money Show. You can find on, you know, through iTunes, Stitcher, you name it, all over the place, right? There's usually 15 to 20 minute podcasts that's due. There's a really quick, just good sound bites for entrepreneurs, you know, whether it be personal development, money, business, you name it, right? So that's one way. The other way is you can check out my website, which is www.moneyripples.com. That's MoneyRipples.com. Like that. Yep. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So yeah, check it out. I've got some great, great resources on there as well.
Awesome.
Awesome. I mean, I'm going to go there.
So go there.
I already called myself.
Oh, don't go there.
We're having an important guy on today, and I'm going to make you listen to it. I'll talk about it for our next meeting. So next week, we have, speaking of money, we're taking it to a different level. We have Anmol Singh, who is a stock market expert. He has just killed it in that arena. So I encourage you to go and look more into what Chris Miles is teaching. And then you can take all your extra money and you can learn how to invest it correctly. So I encourage you to be at that show. And Sara, did you just post it? You did.
Yeah.
So there's a link. So make sure that you get registered for that show. It's going to be a great one. And this guy is killing it. He's a young guy and he has just come out on fire. So it'll be interesting to talk to him and learn from him.
Yes. And it would be cool if you could stop by, Chris, too, since you're kind of in the money arena, too, and might have some words of wisdom to join in on the conversation with us. So if you can stop by.
I actually taught over 200 people how to trade stocks and options. That's cool.
Oh, yeah. You should jump in. We'll open up a seat for you and let it maybe do a little quick chat hour or chat minute or so, you know.
Fun. Cool.
So I did want to say thank you to everybody that shared our show today. We really appreciate it because we've been trying to get the word out about it. And obviously our guests are amazing, proof and Chris being here today. So thank you for sharing our show. We really, truly appreciate it and all of your support. My company is obviously a full service social media agency. You can see more on my website at cmedia.net. And Midori?
And my company, I'm all about helping you re-energize your relationship and your lifestyle. And you can go to my website. I have all kinds of free tools and information there. So I have my show, Ultimate Relationship Show, where I interview people such as Chris, who helps us with finances, also people who are sex experts and everything else. But I encourage you to go to my website. You can find it all there, MidoriVerity.com.
Awesome. And remember, if you are looking for more, give more. And we'll see you next Thursday at 10 Pacific and 1 Eastern. Have a great week. Bye, guys.
Bye.